Hi, I'm Andy Buchanan, Executive Director of the Spinal CSF League Foundation. And with me today is Dr. Mark Mamlouk, a neuroradiologist and spinal CSF League specialist, here to discuss his recent paper titled Factors Predictive of Treatment Success in CT-Guided Fibrin Occlusion of CSF-Venous Fistulas, a Multicenter Retrospective Cross-Sectional Study, published this month in the American Journal of Neuroradiology. Dr. Mamlouk, thank you so much for being here.
No, thank you for having me, Andy, and thank you for the rest of the Spinal CSF League Foundation for the invitation on behalf of me and our co-authors as well.
First of all, congratulations on this paper. It's so important and it's groundbreaking for many reasons, most notably that it's an international multi-center study, correct?
Yeah, we had six institutions over the United States and UK with several different neuroradiologists who performed fibrin glue for CSF-venous fistula. And one of our main hypotheses was to see how well fibrin glue occlusion or patching did for CSF-venous fistulas.
Have there been very many multi-center studies looking at anything in regards to spinal CSF leak?
No, it's been challenging to date. Most of the papers, including a lot of ours, have been from single center institutions. And I think this is groundbreaking in the sense that we've essentially established a CSF leak community. And we've collaborated together to see if we can harness all of our data to help provide more accurate numbers on efficacy and incidence, et cetera. So I think it's very exciting, and I have no doubts that this will continue for other groups as well.
I'm always curious about where ideas come from. What was the impetus for this study, and why did you think it was so important to do it?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. So I think we're lucky as a society and for CSF leak patients now that we have three good treatment strategies for CSF-venous fistulas, one being surgery, one being fibrin glue patching or occlusion, and one being embolization. And I think all of them are good treatment strategies. However, there's not a lot of data on each of the individual treatments. When we published our paper a couple of years back on fibrin glue patching for CSF-venous fistulas, it was novel in the sense that it was different than prior reports on how patching did for fistulas. And I think a lot of that had to do with there was just not a lot of information out there with respect to what type of modality was used, how much you, what type of agent you injected, particularly where exactly did you inject. A lot of the prior papers were just, oh, we did this, and there was a little bit, there was information about the actual patching. So our paper on fibrin glue patching a couple years ago really sparked the discussion of how patching can be used. So our multi-institutional study with first author, Dr. Callen, we led a multidisciplinary, multi-group team, and we evaluated to see how good patching did.
Is there a difference between fibrin patching and fibrin occlusion?
No, there's no difference between the actual, they can be synonymous. However, I will say that the term patching is used variably throughout the community and in the literature. And it really matters exactly where you inject. So not all patching is the same. So, but in the context of our paper, patching and occlusion are synonymous.
Can you explain a little bit in layman's terms, maybe about where is it injected exactly?
Yeah, no, that's a good question. So a lot of these fistulas are on the side of the spine in the what we call the paravertebral space or the neuroforamen. And they course along the side of the vertebral body and then drain into the systemic bloodstream. So what we hypothesized in our paper was we wondered if it sounds pretty basic, but you want to match or inject the glue where the actual fistula is. And where the fistula is actually in a different location because it's often not in the epidural space where traditional patches are performed. So sometimes people will say, oh, I had a patch for a CSF-venous fistula, which could be a traditional patch with injectant into the epidural space, but that's not going to occlude the vein because the vein is often not in the epidural space. So our main hypothesis was if we match the glue spread or the glue location to the fistula, will that result in a good outcome.
How were you able to assess that?
We assessed it from a few different standpoints. We first characterized the actual anatomic location of the fistulas, and we identified certain patterns that most fistulas will have. Then we characterized the location of the glue injectant performed by all the doctors, and then we correlated them to see if they were concordant. Subsequently, we then used brain MRIs before and after the treatment and assessed any differences. And lastly, from a clinical perspective, we evaluated patients by combing through the medical records to see if patients had complete or partial or no response to the fibrin glue patching.
One question that's come up from our community regards fibrin, the use of fibrin itself. If fibrin glue dissolves over time, what's the mechanism that keeps the fistula closed after the glue dissolves?
If the vein clots off, then even if the fibrin glue absorbs in your body, there is a high chance that the vein won't reoccur and that the fistula can remain closed. What we've noticed, that's the case in the majority of cases. Sometimes when you close off one vein, the other veins can sprout up and then the fistula can remain active. And this has been the same phenomenon that's been observed with embolization in surgery as well. So it's important to make sure you target all the veins in the particular area, but also be cognizant that if the patient doesn't completely improve, that you may have to do additional treatments or additional evaluation. And that's the same going for the other treatment arms as well.
Do you see subsequent fistulas forming after treatment with fibrin occlusion?
Often not. I would say the majority of the time, the fibrin glue remains closed. If the patient still has symptoms, it's probably that not all the veins were closed and that additional treatment may be needed in that particular case. Some patients rarely may undergo fistulas elsewhere along the spine, and that has been described with all the different three treatment arms as well. We don't really know why that occurs, but I would like to convey that it's not a very high incidence of that. So it's more the exception rather than the rule that you develop additional fistulas, but it can happen.
I wonder if you could comment on one of the findings in your paper about the statistically significant association between concordant spread and clinical improvement.
Yeah, that was one of the main findings in our paper. And the concordant spread between where the glue is and the fistula was statistically significant with clinical improvement. And that kind of makes sense in the sense that you want to inject the glue where the fistula is. And if the glue for some reason didn't go where the fistula is, then clinical improvement wasn't as good. So that was one of the main takeaways from the paper. And the most chance for success is matching the glue spread with where the actual fistula is. And that just speaks to also the importance of accurately characterizing the fistula. Some of these fistulas are very basic with one vein, but sometimes they have multiple veins and very complex. And it speaks to the necessity to accurately characterize that on advanced decubitus myelography.
The other significant association you found was between pre-treatment symptom duration and clinical improvement.
Yeah, that was an interesting one. And I think we kind of somewhat intuitively suspected that, but it really was an interesting finding for us in that patients who have been leaking for longer, even if they had successful treatment, their improvement wasn't as good as patients who were leaking less, not as long. And this also correlates with another group that evaluated for ventral dural tears, and that patients were leaking longer, even if surgically corrected, had less improvement. I don't think we really understand the reason that is, but I think one main takeaway is that it's really advantageous to get evaluated and treated earlier than later.
Could you speak to the perception that fibrin occlusion is a less effective treatment than onyx embolization? Do you have thoughts on that?
Yeah, to be honest, there actually is no study that has compared surgery versus embolization versus glue. And I think a lot of it will depend on which institution you're at and the doctor's comfort level with each of those different treatment arms. What we have seen is that fibrin glue is very effective. It's a minimally invasive treatment. It's easy to do, as shown in our study across multiple different institutions, small and large. So I think going forward, we will have to do some multi-center trials to evaluate the different treatment arms. I think it would be a difficult study to actually do. In short, I think all treatment arms are helpful for this condition. And I think we need to do more evaluation to see if one is better than the other.
Given that this study was done across multiple institutions, were you surprised by the range in success rates? Or did you kind of expect to see the differences that you found from institution to institution?
I think it was kind of what we expected. And I think in our paper, approximately 60% of patients were curative from fibrin glue patching, 35% had partial improvement, and 5% had no improvement. And the numbers are a little bit lower than our initial study for fibrin glue patching for fistulas. However, I think that could be related to just institutional preferences or provider awareness of the actual technique. And I think with more and more use of fibrin glue patching, that there could be a potential learning curve, just like in anything in medicine, any procedure, there could be a learning curve. And I suspect over time that those numbers can get higher and higher.
Yeah, it seems like this study showed that early treatment intervention and the accuracy of the injection placement were the keys to positive outcomes here. So where do we go from here? What are the next steps in educating physicians in this technique to treat patients?
Yeah, I think emphasizing the again, injecting where it matters. A lot of neuroradiologists and radiologists, interventional radiologists, perform a similar procedure for patients with pain, spinal pain, and we inject steroids into the spine for pain relief. And one of the traditional ways to do that is you want to inject the steroid medication around the nerve, and you also want to get medication going in the epidural space to maximize the patient relief from pain. And I think because a lot of physicians are so ingrained in that needle positioning and technique, that has led to when they've tried this for patching for fistulas, they perform the same technique, and that has led to less effective success with fistulas. And then they say, oh, well, maybe I need to give up and do something else. However, we want to convey that it's not the same as a traditional steroid injection, and you want to target the needle in a different location and possibly even use more than one needle if the fistula is complex. So I think education on actual needle placement. I think the good thing, though, is it's if you can perform these traditional spine interventions, then you can also do patching for fistulas. And I think that's good for the whole world in general, given it's a relatively easy procedure to learn.
Wonderful. Is there anything else you'd like to mention about your study that we didn't already cover?
I think overall, I'd just like to part with that. I think we're very excited that we're developing new treatments and further treatments for patients with CSF leaks. For us physicians that see a lot of patients with CSF leaks, we understand the pain that patients have come through. We understand that they've been through many doctors, and many doctors may not believe the symptoms that they undergo. And we just want to say that we hear you and we are here for you. And we think the future is bright for CSF leak evaluation.
Well, thank you so much for your dedication to helping everybody affected by spinal CSF leak.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.